set time to be holy. Speak off with thy Lord. Abide in him always, and feed on his word. Make friends of God's children. Help those who are weak, forgetting in nothing his blessing to see. Take time to be holy. The world rushes on. Spend much time in secret with Jesus alone. By looking to Jesus, like him thou shalt be. Thy friends in thy conduct his likeness shall see. Take time to be holy. Let him be thy guide, and run not before him, whatever betide, in joy or in sorrow. Still follow thy Lord, and looking to Jesus, still trust in his word. Take time to be holy. Be calm in thy soul. Each thought and each temper beneath his control. Thus, led by his Spirit, the fountains of love, thou shalt soon be fitted for service above.
Praise the Lord. Shall we all be on our feet? Open your mouth and say, Lord Jesus, speak to me this evening. Ask the Lord to minister to you this evening. The Lord is in our midst. King of glory has come to minister to you this night. Say, oh Lord, minister to me. Is everything, Jesus is everything. Is everything, Jesus is everything. He's my wisdom, my knowledge, my ever understanding. He's everything. Jesus is everything. He is everything. He's my wisdom, my knowledge, my ever understanding. He's everything to me. We need someone that will help us interpret in Igbo language outside. Heavenly Father, we worship you. King of glory, we are before you, Lord. We ask that may you remind us of the promise of your coming. Almighty Father, we are asking that at the end of this message, this night, this evening, every one of us, we have the cause to glorify your name. Our God and our Father, our gathering is not unto man but unto thee. We ask that may you bless our soul this night. We ask that may you bless our love this night. We ask that may your name be glorified in our midst this night. Jesus' name we pray. Have your seat. The topic before us this evening is a very important message. It's a reminder of what the Lord says he will do. The topic is living the rapturable Christian life. Living the rapturable Christian life. I will love everyone to recite it. Living the rapturable Christian life. To be rapturable means to be rapture ready. To be rapturable means to be conscious of the rapture. To be rapturable means to be prepared to welcome the King. For all that are born again, for all that are children of God, know that the King will appear very soon. Your Creator, my Creator, your God, my God, will soon return. He is not coming as a Messiah to save sinners, for he has done that. This time around, the Lord is coming as a King. This time around, the Lord is coming not longer as the Savior of the whole world, but he is coming as a rewarder to give unto every man according as his deeds, according to your service, according to your faithfulness. The master is coming soon. Help me tell the person sitting by you, our master is coming soon. Yes, that is the message before us this evening. Brethren, can we turn our Bible to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 15 verse 51. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 verse 51. 1 Corinthians 15 verse 51 to 52. Verse 51, the Bible says, behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. He says, behold, I show you a mystery. The thing we are going to discuss this evening, if you want to use your human knowledge to calculate it, you will be wrong. The matter of the rapture, the event that will take place on that day, If you want to use your knowledge, your human brain to calculate it, you will miss it. Therefore, the Lord, the Bible calls it a mystery. It is a mystery because you cannot explain it, that you are sitting together with a fellow human being. You didn't even hear a sound of a trumpet, yet the person has disappeared. That you are sleeping together with your wife on a bed and you are discussing, you are laughing, suddenly you turn around only to discover that it is only you on bed. Brethren, is that not a mystery? Behold, I show you a mystery. It is mystery indeed. It is divine mystery. It is what man cannot be able to calculate. No thing. Your brain cannot give you the results. It takes faith to believe that which the Lord says, he will bring it to pass. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16. The Bible says, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trump, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up. The word rapture is being represented in the New Testament. Actually, you may not find the word rapture in the Bible, but you will find the word caught up. To be raptured means to be caught up. To be raptured means for a power to lift you up. A power that lifted Jesus Christ from Mount Olivet is the same power that will lift you up. That is why the Bible calls it a mystery. Brethren, I have told us that to be rapturable means to be rapture ready. In our days, we discover people that call themselves Christian. We discover people that call themselves children of God, who are supposed to be conscious of this event. Most times you will see them very careless. Most times you will see a Christian very careless, behaving very careless, talking very careless, relating with sinner with all kind of carelessness. No consciousness, no carefulness, not being mindful that the trumpet will sound. Brethren, the Lord gather us today so that he might remind us, so that he might record into our mind the promises of the rapture. It's our prayer that after the teaching this evening, it is our prayer that after the word this evening, you will become more serious. You will become more ready. You, in fact, your thinking, as you are waking up from sleep, your thought will be, what if the trumpet will sound today? As you are going back to sleep, you will be telling your husband good night. You'll be telling your parent good night. Your calculation will be, what if the rapture will take place this night? Because it can come at any time. There will be no sign. There will be not a proof, nothing will prove to you. There will be no sign, nothing will show that today is that day. Only for you to wake up and hear radio making announcement, and hear people talking, and hear people, two men standing together and are discussing. This one say, I don't know, I cannot trace my child since yesterday. Another one say, I don't know where my wife has been to. Another one, being it will down on you who has Bible knowledge that they have gone. You will be there. I say you will be there. My brethren, this is a reality. It is a promise. Jesus himself gave this promise. He said, I am coming back again. Can Jesus lie? Can Jesus lie? It means we are expecting him. We are expecting the coming king. We are expecting the redeemer. And the Lord will make us ready in Jesus' name. So I have told us that the meaning of rapturable, to live rapturable life, I say it needs to be ready. And we discover again that to be rapturable means to live a life of self-examination. To live, how will a believer live rapture ready? How will a child of God live rapture ready? Is for you to live a life of self-examination. Let's see. Turn to the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 13. Live a life of personal self-examination. Personal self-examination. 2 Corinthians chapter 13. Chapter 13, verse 5. Verse 5, the Bible says, examine yourself whether ye be in the faith. Prove your own self. Know ye not yourself? How that Jesus Christ is in you, except ye be what? Reprobate. He said, examine yourself. How will I live a rapturable life? How to live a rapture ready is for me to place myself on self-examination. I remember when we were in school, there are these wise students that anytime they are preparing for exam, probably WAEC, they will go and look for some past question papers and begin to practice them. They will say, assuming the question comes this way, assuming the lecturer or the WAEC people ask question on this topic, can I be able to answer it? They will set some question before them and begin to work on it. Began to exercise that knowledge, began to ask themselves, assuming the question comes on atom, what is this, what is that, can I be able to answer it well? The Bible gives the same suggestion. He says, for you to live a rapture ready life, for you to live a life that you will not see disappointment, you should place yourself under self-examination. Ask yourself, assuming the angel of God confront me that day on the issue of restitution, am I clean? Assuming the angels of God at the probably by death or rapture, assuming at the gate of heaven, the angel of God a kind of confront me with this question on church, I mean money management in church, how I manage church fund, how
how I manage the movement form, will I be found guilty? Ask yourself. Ask yourself. Place yourself on some examination. Ask yourself some question. Begin to answer yourself, assuming the Lord come today. Check your relationship with your neighbor. Check your relationship with your wife. Check your relationship with your children. Check your relationship with whoever is around you. Place yourself on this personal examination. Place yourself on this personal examination. Begin to ask yourself questions. How is my life in this area? How is my life in this area? How is my life in this? Begin to judge yourself. If you judge yourself, you will not be judged. If you check yourself, prepare yourself, get yourself ready, the rapture will not pass you by. But if you are a careless Christian, very weak Christian, Christian that talk anyhow, Christian that can jest anyhow, Christian that can handle church money anyhow, Christian that can do things anyhow, you keep procrastinating your restitution. My brother, you yourself know that you are condemned. You yourself know that you will not make it. The Lord will help us to make it. Amen. Yes, we said to be rapture ready is to place yourself on self-examination. Now, I want us to look at something. The topic, living the rapturable Christian life, is a message to the Church of Jesus Christ. It's not a message to a sinner. As for the sinner, they don't even know whether Jesus is coming back. Do they even know that Jesus came? As for the sinner, they don't know. In fact, I remember something happened in a community somewhere. The believers in that village or in that community have a son. The son said, "Lord Jesus, come now. Come and take us home. Lord Jesus, come now. Come." One day they were sinking the son. A man I know so well confronted them and said, "You, this Christian, I don't know what is wrong with you. Jesus is staying in heaven. He is doing his activity. He knew that I am not born again. He knew that many of us are still sinners. Why are you disturbing him to come now? Don't you know that I'm not born again? Don't you know that I'm still a sinner?" When you say Jesus is coming back to a sinner, his heart cut. To a sinner, his fear gripped him. To a sinner, his heart trembled, because he knows he's not ready. Are you ready? Are you ready to receive Jesus? You must be a child of God. You must be a born again child of God. Before you will even think of welcoming the King, your name must be in the book of life. That is why I wanted to discuss this. That the message to live rapturable is a message that is directing to the church. Who is a church? A church is a body of Christ. A church is one people who are member of his body. We said the message we are handling this evening is a message that is coming to the Church of Jesus Christ. Are you a member of his body? Are you washed from your sin? Are you purified? Our daddy taught us this afternoon on sanctification. Are you sanctified? The Lord will help us. Now, if this message is directing to a church, then we want to look at it in this way. We want to divide it into, we want to divide the church into two groups or two phases. One, we want to see what is the reaction of the early church towards this same commandment. I am coming back. Jesus says, "I am coming back." Before he went to heaven, he told the disciple, I am what? Coming back. What was the reaction of the first church, the first body of Christ, towards this commandment? Let's turn our Bible to the book of Acts of the Apostle. Acts of the Apostle. Acts of the Apostle, chapter 1, the early church. The early church lived a rapture-ready life. They live a rapturable life. Let's see what happened. Acts of the Apostle, chapter 1, verse 11. Let's start from verse 10. And while they looked steadfastly towards heaven, as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus. Everybody said, this same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven. Jesus gathered the disciples and he told them, Son of Man will be going. He told them, I will be leaving you. I will be returning to my Father. I am going back to my Father and your Father. And on this dreadful day, actually, the disciples were thinking, how will it be? Lord, you are leaving us. You say you are going away. That is why they begin to be asking themselves, who now will be our leader? Like joke, like play, a day came that Jesus took them to a mountain. Before they know, they saw a power lifting him. Before they know, they saw a power lifting him. And he was going. And he was going. And he was going. And behold, they saw some men in white clothes appear and asked them, men of Galilee, why are you looking up to heaven steadfastly, looking so surprised, looking so discouraged, looking so downcasted, looking as if there is no hope? The Lord have sent us to come and confirm, to come and assure you that this same Jesus, I said this same Jesus, whom you see going up, in the same manner he will descend. In like manner, he will come back. In this way, he will come back. And as the men were saying this, the mystery sank down into the heart of the apostle. And the Bible said, remember, we are considering the attitude of the first church towards this same commandment. The character of the first church towards the commandment of his coming, towards this hope of the believer that Jesus is coming back. They went back to Jerusalem and the Bible said they did a thing because they were expecting Jesus, because they were hoping to see him, because their eyes are on the way. They know that the Lord Jesus, who told them he is coming back, cannot tell lie. The angels of heaven came and confirmed it and assured them that Jesus is coming back. The Bible said the disciples went back to Jerusalem and did a thing. We want to look at those things. Those things are character of people. These are the things that if you see in a life of someone, you know that this person is ready for the coming of Jesus. Hallelujah. Yes, the disciples went back to Jerusalem and have time for the word of God. They went back to Jerusalem. In Acts of the Apostles, chapter 2, the Bible said they went back to Jerusalem knowing that the Lord will come. Knowing that the Master will come. Knowing that the Creator will come. They went back to Jerusalem. They went back to Jerusalem. And let's read chapter 1, Acts of the Apostles, chapter 1, verse 14. They did the thing. The Bible said, and this all continued with one accord in prayer and what? Supplication. They know that the coming of Jesus is sure. They know that the rapture will take place any moment from now. The Bible said, as they went back to Jerusalem, they refused to go for business. They refused to go for other things. They were looking as if Jesus will come back in 2 days' time. They were looking as if Jesus will come back in 2 weeks' time. They were so expecting of his coming, so much that the Bible said they came together and had fellowship together. Verse 14 said, and this all continued with one accord, praying in prayer and supplication. Prayer and supplication. They all continue in fellowship. Let's see chapter 2 of the same book, chapter 2, verse 20, verse 40, verse 40, 42, verse 42. The Bible says, and they continue steadfastly in the apostle doctrine and in fellowship, in breaking of bread and in prayers. See, these are the character of the first church. The Bible said the first church had daily Bible study. They continued daily in the word of God. They continued daily in breaking of bread, in prayers, in fellowship, because they were expecting the coming of Christ. They were expecting the coming of Christ. And we say, a children of God, a child of God that is conscious of the return of Christ, a child of God that is hoping for the return of Christ, you will see this character in her, that she will love the word of God. She will love Bible. She will love the word of God. She will love fellowship of the brethren. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. The Bible said they continue daily. The Bible said the early church had a common greeting. In our days, when you see believers, or maybe, yeah, you see believers meet themselves, one of the common language you see among us is, God bless you. God bless you. Am I right? In the early church, one of the common language among them is Maranatha. One of the common language among the early church is what? Maranatha. Maranatha means, come, Lord Jesus. People that are ready, people that love the word of God, people that have time for the word of God, people that have time for fellowship. We said in the first church, you saw them in continued fellowship. It's in our days that if a chapter leader in Holiness Revival Movement decided to introduce Bible study, you will see members complaining. Horimo is not a church. Why is Horimo introducing Bible study? Horimo is not a church. Why? I asked somebody,
Who told you that Bible study belonged to a denominational church? Who told you that Bible study belonged to denominational church? The Bible said, and they continued daily in one accord, studying the word of God, having fellowship with one another. The Lord will create love for the word of God in our heart. Amen. The Lord will create love for fellowship. I want to tell you something. Hallelujah. I want us to discuss some things on this topic of having fellowship. The Bible says, ye shall not forsake the assembly of ourselves together. Why? Something is there. The Bible said we should not forsake. The psalmist said, I am so glad when they say, let us go to the house of the Lord. Because there are unique miracles that take place when children of God come together in fellowship. Do you want to know about it? Do you want to know the unique miracle that takes place? One miracle takes place when children of God gather together in fellowship. First John chapter 1 verse 7. First John chapter 1 verse 7. If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and the truth is not in us. Verse 7. But if we walk in light as he is in light, we have fellowship one with another. We have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, does what? When believers come together in fellowship, when children of God come together in fellowship, the Bible said the blood of Jesus cleanses us as we come together, as we worship God together. There is a miracle of general cleansing. There is a miracle of the blood of Jesus purifying you, cleansing us, and making us holy. That is number one miracle. Number two, I want us to go to the book of Acts of the Apostle again. We see the book of Acts of the Apostle again and see something that happened when the church of God come together in fellowship. Praise the name of the Lord. When the church of God come together in fellowship. Acts of the Apostle chapter 2. Acts of the Apostle chapter 2 verse 1. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And when the days of Pentecost was fully come, they were all together in one accord. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it sat upon each of them. Listen. Jesus promised the disciple two things. One of it is the coming of the Comforter. One of it is the coming of who? The Comforter. And the second is the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. One thing surprised me here. Jesus said, remain in Jerusalem until the Comforter come. The disciple didn't know when the Comforter will come. Just like you and I didn't know when the rapture will take place. The disciple, one thing that shocked me is, I asked myself this question, why didn't the Comforter come when the disciples were doing maybe the various activities in the market? The Bible says, when the days of Pentecost fully come, the days of Pentecost was the day that the believer came together like holiness conference in this campground. The days of Pentecost was the day that all the believers congregate in Jerusalem. As they were busy worshiping God, as they were busy serving God, the Bible says they had a sound. The Bible says suddenly the Holy Ghost descended on them. I wonder the person that was not in fellowship that day. I wonder the one that decided to travel out that day. I wonder at that one that said, there are many days of Pentecost. If I didn't come this one, I can come another time. Brethren, when I was reading this place, my heart caught. I said, see how God loved holiness revival movement. See how God has been saying holiness revival movement is mine. See the kind of attention God gave holiness revival movement. If you read the revelation of the white man 1961, that revelation says that those group of people will end at rapture. Go and read it well. Go and study it well. I now ask myself, if the Holy Ghost waited until the believer gathered in Jerusalem, I fear if rapture would not take place while we are in holiness conference. You that will carelessly say, I cannot come to this conference, brother. Yet I am not saying the Bible says so. But remember, the Bible says, study the fig trees. Study the fig tree means study events. Study the way things are going. Check out. Jesus promised two things. One, he said the Holy Ghost will come. Two, he said him himself will come. And the Holy Ghost came in the day of general conference. The Holy Ghost appeared in the camp. Let me show you something. Some similarity in the coming of the Holy Ghost and the coming of the rapture. The Bible says, and suddenly, verse 1, chapter 2, he said, and when the days of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place, and suddenly. And what? Suddenly. Suddenly means in a twinkling of an eye, within a short time. Is this not one of the characteristics of the rapture? The Bible said the rapture will stop on in the twinkling of an eye. The Bible said the rapture will happen in a twinkling of an eye. Before you close your eyes and open it, has happened. And suddenly, hey, Father, have mercy. And suddenly, there came a sound. Check the teaching of the rapture. You will hear the word sound there, and the trumpet shall sound. And suddenly, there came a sound. Brethren, I am telling you this. Though it's not biblical, it's not written in the Bible like this, but study the fig trees. Study the move of things. If the trumpet, if the Holy Ghost came on the days of fellowship, you that can carelessly give excuse and say, for this my business, I cannot come. You know, my uncle daughter is getting married. I cannot come in this conference. I fear my brother. I fear my sister. I fear if the rapture would not take place in the days of our conference. Because the Lord said he always cleans us when we are together in fellowship. If the rapture take place now, many people will go to heaven. But if the rapture take place where you are in your farm, I am not, except God show mercy. May God show us mercy. Yeah. By this knowledge, respect the gathering of the brethren. By this knowledge, my brother, my sister, I am not saying scripture says so, but by this knowledge, I am begging you in the name of the Lord, as much as possible, come when the Lord is calling us together. May God help us in Jesus' name. Yes, miracle take place when the brethren gather together. Divine miracle, wonderful miracle, great thing, and the Lord have told us that. Because of our time, we will go to the second topic, the church in our day. We have seen the early church. We have seen how they gave attention to fellowship, how they gave attention to the word of God, how they gave attention to divine thing. You, your attention is on earthly thing. How to acquire, how to get this, how to get degree, how to get master, how to travel abroad and be big and own a perishable certificate. I was preaching somewhere. I asked the brethren, I said, have you ever seen an educated man? The one that read and in fact society respect him. The day he died, all the doctor gather and said, no, we can't waste this brain. We can't waste this brain. Let's operate him and remove the brain and give to one of his child. Have you ever seen it like that? A wasted effort, wasted energy, wasted it. King Solomon gathered the wealth of this life. He had it to the point. In fact, if you talk of wisdom, talk of material things, they are there. Talk of whatever, the man, even the woman he gathered, even thousand. One day Solomon said, my pain is this. All these things I have gathered, when I die, because you will die. He said, when I die, I don't know who will succeed me. Whether he will be a foolish child or a wise child. All these things you are gathering, my brother, they are perishable things. They are perishable things. Let it be that you have how many hectares of land? Your land. If we talk of property, you have it and have it again. The day you die, the day you leave this world, in fact, the people you left behind, they are so stingy that they will not bury you in 50 by 50 land. Rather, they will go to the hospital and measure your cup and see how your heart is, so that you will not occupy the whole land. See how you're wasting your time. Wasting your time on earthly things, and you forget the precious thing. You forget the coming of the rapture, because your attention is on earthly things. The first church never do that. They have time for God. They have time for Bible. They have time for fellowship. May God cause us to be like them. Yeah. You that is fighting Horimo Bible study. Why is holding the Bible man introducing Bible study? Careless Christian, weak Christian, you don't want to study Bible. How will you go to heaven? You don't want to eat the word of God. How will your spirit be strong? A man told me, Pastor, I am not coming to Bible study because I am too busy. He said he's too busy. I asked him a question. I said, sir, how many hours do we have in a day? He says 24 hours. I said, in these 24 hours you have in a day, if the God that created you say, you know I'm your God, I am the one that give you life, give me 20 hours and take 4 hours, will you have argued it? Will you have challenged God? Will you have said no? If God said, give me 20 hours of your life every day, come before me 20 hours and take only 4 hours, why would you have said? But God show you mercy. God show you mercy. God show you mercy. And he is just saying, my daughter, in the whole week, come before me in 2 hours. Just 2 hours. 24 times 7. 24 hours in the day times 7 days. The God of heaven is just asking 2 hours from you. You say you are too busy. You are too busy. That is why if you are not careful, the trumpet will sound. You will not be there. How will you be there? Market has taken you away. How will you be there? The time you're supposed to be in fellowship, you are busy doing other things. You are busy doing other things. You are busy. I repeat this, that don't be surprised that the rapture will take place when children of God are in fellowship. Sometimes it may not be a general program like this, but the Holy Ghost may stir it up in the heart of leaders. They will organize program in the various states, not knowing that the Holy Spirit is telling them the time is at hand. The time is at hand. But these are too busy activities. These are too busy life. How will you hear? How will you go? How will you know? May God help us to know. May God help us to know. May God help us to be ready. Lastly, brethren, Jesus is coming for a church, not for sinner. Are you aware of that? If Jesus is coming for a church, then we want to say little thing about the church, then we close. Ephesians chapter 5. Jesus is not coming for sinners. He is coming for the church whom he died for. Jesus Christ is coming for the church. He is not coming for sinner. Ephesians chapter 5 verse 26. Are you there? Ephesians chapter 5 verse 26. The Bible says that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the world, that he may sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of the water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious what? That he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having what? Not having what? Now pause and look up. The problem of the church is not that the church is a total sinner. No. The church is a redeemed. These are a group of redeemed people. People that are redeemed by the blood of Jesus. But something will disqualify the church. Something will make the church not to go in the rapture. And the Bible called that thing what? Brethren, what is sports? When a man gives his life to Jesus, the God of heaven has a garment called garment of righteousness. The garment of righteousness is white throughout. You don't see any small thing, small spot on it. The Lord put it on you on the day you were born again. The warning is that you should keep that garment without spots. We are not saying you are a fornicator. At your level, maybe you have overcome that one. We are not saying you are a murderer. Maybe at your level you don't kill again. We are not even saying you are a thief, because in fact at your level, no, you don't steal. The problem of the church is something very negligible. That thing you say, does it really matter, can constitute spots in your garment. That thing you say, is it not only this one, can form what is called spots. And if your garment is spotted, if your garment carries spots, the Bible says Jesus is coming for a church without spots. See how you can talk against your fellow brother. If you carry maybe you carry a sister or carry a brother to your leader, see how you finish him. Your leader will look at that brother, look at that sister, as if, oh, this is a chronic sinner. Maybe you frame it. Maybe you, in fact, it's just a little grudge in your heart against him. You finish that brother, and yet you carry big Bible, come and sit in the church and say, Jesus is coming, we are going. There is spot in your life. Jesus is coming for a church without spot, a church without wrinkle, a church without spot. Check your life. We were told of a man of God that died. When he fell down, his soul came out. He saw himself in a white ground. He was rejoicing and was running to heaven until the angel said, stop. And said, check your garment. The man of God looked and checked and looked. We were told the man didn't discover that small thing, because it is too small, until the angel had to help him. Say, look at the side of your pocket. The man looked and saw a spot. He saw what? A spot. So just one small thing, so negligible. In your own way, you look down on it. Will this really take me to hell? In your own way, you ask yourself, just this ring, how can this ring take me to hell? The Bible says, in the multitudes of ways, they lacketh no sin. See how you talk. If you began to criticize a brother, if you began to criticize a sister, sometimes if I hear believer talking about another believer, I say, did this person really know what the Bible means by in the multitudes of ways they lacketh no sin? Brother, we are not saying you are not a Christian. We are not saying you are not a child of God. But we are saying, watch your garment. Any garment that has a spot is a small roundish different color in a particular uniform color. If you have a spot, very negligible as it is, you won't go to rapture. You won't follow Jesus. Now the question is this. This one spot that will disqualify you going to heaven, where will it take you to? Where will it take you to? My pain about hell is this. Hellfire is like prison. If you go to prison, you will discover a man that killed person is in prison. The one that stole a car is in prison. The one that just tell a big man stupid. The big man say, you insult me, I will show you, is also in prison. The one that stole handsel of 2005 is also in prison. The one that stole an egg, how much is an egg, is also in prison. That is how hellfire is. You mean after all this suffering, after all this coming to comfort, after all this prayer and fasting, after all this Christianity you have lived all this while, a spot will carry you to where sinful men are, wicked politicians, terrible civil servants, the people that deprive us of our national cake. We are suffering. God is going to punish them in hell. You, one spot is taking you there. You agree? One spot. Maybe because the way you manage the money of the chapter, you are a leader over just a unit. Hey, I don't have money today, carry 1,000. I don't have money tomorrow, carry 1,000. And the trumpet sound, you think you will go, the angel say, check your garment. Check your garment. Have you paid that money? Have you done that restitution? Brethren, we will ask God for cleansing of spots. The Lord will clean from us any spots, anything that form wrinkle in our body, anything that forms spot in your garment of righteousness. It is time to take care of it. It is time to cry to God for cleansing. Why will you go to hell after all this suffering? After all this abuse and insult from the world? After all this suffering? See how you are sleeping. See how you don't have food to eat. No water. You say, I must come to comfort. At the end of this journey, brethren, a single thing can stop you going to heaven. And that single thing is called spots. Are you ready to clean the spots? Yes. Are you ready to do the rest? See how you finish that sister. Go to the sister and say, I'm sorry. Go to that brother and say, I'm sorry. Do the restitution. Clean up yourself. Control your tongue. Brethren, control your tongue so that this journey will not be in vain. May God show us mercy. May God cleanse us. May God sanctify us. Be on your feet as we go before God in prayer. Say, Lord Jesus, show me mercy. Will I run this race in vain? Will I run this race in vain? Oh Lord, remove the spot from my life. Oh Lord, remove the spot from my life, the wrinkle. Jesus is coming for a church without spot nor wrinkle. Jesus is coming for a church without spot nor wrinkle. Without spot nor wrinkle. Can you ask God for cleansing? Can you ask God for cleansing? Can you ask God for cleansing? The Lord is here to cleanse you. The Lord is here to cleanse you. The Lord is here to cleanse you. Can you request? Say, Lord Jesus, cleanse me. Remove this spot from my garment. Remove this spot from my garment. Remove this spot from my garment. Oh Lord Jesus, show me mercy.
Amen.
Show me mercy. Show me mercy. The trumpet will soon sound. The trumpet will soon sound. The rapture will soon take place. The rapture will soon take place. Will you be there? Will you be there? Will you be there? Jesus is coming. Jesus is coming. Jesus is coming. He is coming for a church without spots. A church without spots. Yes. Pray that God must show you mercy. Ask for mercy. Ask for mercy. Ask for mercy. Show us mercy, Lord. Show us mercy, Lord. A church without spots. A church without spots. Of that spot in your life, you know it. Check your garment well, check your Christian life well. You know of that particular spot in your life, and you want the Lord to cleanse it this night. Are you ready for the Lord to cleanse it this night? Raise up your hand before the Lord. You need cleansing. The Bible says, when we come together in fellowship, like the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanses us from unrighteousness. You know there is spot in your life. You know it. You know it. You want the Lord to cleanse you. Raise up your hand and begin to confess that spot. Say, Lord Jesus, I have examined myself. I have checked myself. I discover this is the area. I discover this is the area. And the Lord will show you mercy. Jesus' name we pray. Quiet everywhere. Silence everywhere. I want us to pray this prayer together. Say, Lord Jesus, I am your child. I know I am born again. But of a truth, there is a spot in my life. Lord, I want you to remove this spot in my life today. It's a spot of anger, mismanagement of phone, talkativeness, lusting, and many others. Lord Jesus, I come before you. Wash me with your precious blood. Wash me with your precious blood. keep me rapturable. Keep me rapture ready. In Jesus' name we pray. Almighty Father, we appreciate this great love you have shown us. Divine, if we were dead before now, with this spot in our life, we know we will have missed it. But your love preserve us. Your love keep us to these days, so that you might cleanse us. Divine, see your children standing before you, and they are asking for cleansing. Almighty Father, may you cleanse us. Divine God, may you cleanse us. Righteous Redeemer, may you cleanse us. Oh Lord Jesus, give us power to become your children. Give us power to become a church without spots, a church without wrinkle, a church without defilement. Divine, wash us with your precious blood. Wash us with your precious blood. Thank you, my Father, for you have answered our prayers. May you communicate peace to our hearts. May our heart receive peace now. May our heart receive peace now. Thank you, Jesus. We are saying, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus. Come, Lord Jesus, and take us to rest. For in Jesus' wonderful name we pray. And amen. Have your seat.
The message you have just listened to is a production of Holiness Revival Movement Worldwide. Holiness Revival Movement Worldwide is a non-denominational ministry that is given to the propagation of Christ's righteousness and holiness in churches and nations of the world through crusades, revival meetings, production and spread of holiness literature and materials. For other spiritual materials, messages, or inquiries, contact us on 0816-902-3948 or 0805-683-4323. You can also reach us through our email address, holinessrevivalmovement@gmail.com. God bless you.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Hallelujah. Jesus, I believe in you. You are my Lord and Savior. I believe. Savior, you left your
Yeah. Jesus, I believe in you.
I believe in you.
Cause you are my Lord and Savior.
You are my Lord and Savior.
Jesus, I believe in you.
I believe in you,
Lord. Cause you are
a living Savior.
Jesus, I believe in you, Lord. Cause
you are my Lord and Savior.
You are my Lord and Savior, Lord.
I believe.
That's why I believe in you, Lord. Oh, Jesus.
You are my living Savior.
I believe in you. You are the living Savior. I believe in you. I love you, Lord.
I love
you. I believe. Savior.
Jesus, I believe in
you. I believe in you.
You are my Lord and Savior.
You
Lord.
Are my Lord and Savior. I believe in you.
Lord. Oh,
you are my living Savior. I believe in you. You are my Lord and Savior. I believe in you. You are the living Savior.
You came chased me with your blood. You are my Lord and my Savior. You left your throne above and took up the form of a servant for my sin.
Jesus, I believe in you.
I believe in you.
Cause you are my Lord and Savior.
You are my Lord and Savior.
Jesus, I believe in you.
I believe in you.
Savior.
I believe you, Lord, 'cause you